Hello everyone, welcome to this video lecture of Irrigation Engineering. This is Sukamal Ghosh, Assistant Professor, Civil Engineering Department, Greater Kolkata College of Engineering and Management, JS Group. In this particular video lecture, we are going to discuss about design of line canals. So before knowing about the design procedure of line canals, we should know about the design parameters. So these are the various design parameters of line canals according to Indian standard 10430. Okay, so the first design parameter is side slopes, then the freeboard, the berm, the bank top width, the dowel, which is also known as dowla in local language, the roadway and drainage near the canals, the typical cross sections of line canals, the discharge and the velocity of water flowing through the line canals, and of course the under drainage. So let's discuss all the design parameters one by one. Okay, now, so the side slopes are basically two types, the inner side slopes and the outer side slopes. Lining is usually made to rest on stable slopes of the natural soil. So slope should be such that no earth pressure and or any other external pressure is exerted over the back of the lining. Sudden drawdown of water level in the line canal should be controlled by strict operation rules and regulations to avoid the external pressure on the lining. However, where the chance of sudden drawdown in the canal is considerable, the canal slope should be checked for stability using the slip circle analysis as given in Indian standard 7894. Okay. Now, in addition, other suitable measures like adequate drainage should be provided before the lining works commence. As a rule, steeper slopes are economical, but stable slopes depending on the types of soil are preferred. Okay, now, so the engineering properties of soil shall govern the design of outer side slopes of line canals. The recommended side slopes according to Indian standard 10430-2000 for the line canals has been given in this particular table. So if the soil is very light loose sand to the average sandy soil, then the side slope for the line canal should be 2:1 to 3:1 for both in cutting and also in embankment. But if the type of soil is sandy loam, then in cutting the side slope of the line canal should be 1.5:1 to 2:1. But for the same soil, means for the same sandy loam, for in embankment, the side slope of the line canal should be 2:1. Now if the type of soil is sandy gravel or marum, then in cutting the side slope of the line canal should be 1.5:1, and in embankment the side slope should be 1.5:1 to 2:1. In this way, for different types of soils, the values, or you can say the recommended values of side slopes for the line canal has been given in Indian standard 10430-2000. Now, the slope values which are recommended in this particular table for for depth of cutting or the height of embankment up to 6 meters. It means if the depth or the height is more than 6 meters, or you can say if the depth or the height exceeds 6 meters, then special study for the stability of slope are recommended. Okay, now, so the freeboard shall be measured from the full supply level to the top of the lining. Minimum free board for different type of canal discharge has been given in this table. So if the canal discharge is more than 10 cumex, then the minimum freeboard should be 0.75 meter. If the canal discharge is between 3 cumec to 10 cumecs, then the minimum freeboard should be 0.60 meter. If the canal discharge is between 1 to 3 cumecs, then the minimum freeboard should be 0.50 meter. If the canal discharge is less than 1 and less than 0.1, then the minimum freeboard must be 0.30 and 0.15 respectively. Okay, now, so if the canal discharge exceeds 10 meter cube per second and if the fill height exceeds 6 meter, then we should provide berms of 3 meter to 5 meter width on each side of the canal. Now this berm should be provided for stability, the facility of maintenance, silt clearance, etc. You can see here, this is a cross section of the line canal and this is the canal bed. Okay, this is the canal bed, these two are the banks of the canal, and you can see here, this is the berm. Okay, this portion is berm, and also in this bank, this portion is berm. Okay, now the sections in which the discharge capacity exceeds 10 cumecs, the inner side above the berm may be provided by turfing. Okay, now, so the width of the banks may vary according to the importance and capacity of canal. In case of distributaries, the service road should be provided on one bank for inspection and for maintenance purpose. However, in the case of main and branch canals, service road should be provided on both the banks. Now, the minimum value of top width of the bank for different type of canal discharge is given in this particular table. So, if the canal discharge is between 0.15 to 1.5 cumec, then the top width of the inspection bank should be minimum of 4 meter. But for the same discharge, means for the discharge capacity of 0.15 to 1.5 cumecs, the top width of the non-inspection bank should be 1.5 meter. Now again, if the discharge capacity is 1.5 to 3 cumecs for a canal, then the top width for the inspection bank and the non-inspection bank should be minimum of 4 meter and 2 meter respectively. Okay, now again, if the canal discharge is between 3 to 10 cumecs, then the top width of the inspection bank should be minimum of 4 meter plus the width of dowel. Okay, and for this particular discharge of a canal, the non-inspection bank width or the top width should be minimum of 2.5 meter for a line canal. In this way, for different types of discharge or different values of discharge, we have to provide a minimum bank top width. Okay, and these values are corresponding to this discharges. Okay, now the bank width which is given in this particular table, you know, may be altered when justified by specific conditions. Okay, now, so for the distributary canals which are carrying less than 3 meter cube per second of discharge, and for the minor canals, it is generally not economical to construct a service road on the top of the bank, because if we construct or provide a service road on the top of the bank, then it will require more material than the excavation, and if more construction material required in the construction of this service road, then it will be not economical. Okay, now Where the stability of the embankment is required, the wider bank width can be provided. It means, see, whatever values of the minimum bank top width we have discussed in this particular table can be altered. Okay, if you know the stability of the embankment is required, then these values, whichever we have discussed in this table, can be increased. Okay, so the bank top width can be increased in case of the stability of embankment is required. Okay, also in hilly terrain where it is not possible to provide the prescribed bank width, the bank width may be suitably reduced. Okay, so in hilly area if it is not possible to provide this bank width, because in hilly area the area the area is very small, so it may not be possible to provide this much width. Okay, so according to the need we can suitably reduce the bank top width. Okay, now so suitable dowels may be provided on the canal side of the service road on one or both the banks depending upon the type and the size of line canals. You can see here this is a cross section of a line canal and these are the dowels. Okay, so we can provide the dowel on only one bank or we may provide the dowels on the both of the banks. So whether we will provide this dowel on only one bank or in both the bank, it depends upon the type and the size of the line canal. Okay, now from the economic consideration, dowel may be replaced by the parapets, particularly in case of high embankment. Okay, so in the case of high embankment we can replace this dowels with the parapet walls. Okay, now so whenever additional spoil banks are to be provided on the land side of the embankment, adequate drainage channel should be provided. Okay, you can see here this is the cross section of a canal and this is the canal. Okay, and these are the spoil banks. So whenever we provide this spoil banks, we should provide the drainage. Okay, this is the drain. Let me change the color. See, this is the drainage. Okay, and in this bank this is the drainage. Okay, and drainage should be provided with suitable slopes on the roadway sloping away from the channel site. Okay, now no rain water should be allowed to flow or to percolate towards the channel slope behind this lining. Okay, now generally for the line canals two types of cross sections are used. For smaller channel section, the triangular section with the circular bottom is used, and for the large canal sections, a trapezoidal section with rounded bottom is used. Okay, now according to Indian Standard 10430/2000, the trapezoidal section with or without rounded corner is used for all the types of line canals. And if the line canal is basically distributary canal or the minor canals, and if the discharge is up to 3 cumex, then we can use the cup shaped cross section. Okay, now so you can see here this is a triangular cross section with the circular bottom, and generally we use this kind of section for smaller channels. Okay, and this is a trapezoidal cross section with rounded corners, and generally we use this kind of cross section for larger channels. Okay, now this is A trapezoidal channel without rounded corner, and according to Indian standard 10430-2000, we can use this type of cross section for all the types of line canals. Okay, and this is a cup shaped cross section of line canal. According to Indian standard 10430-2000, this type of cross section should be used for the distributaries or the miners where the discharge of the canal is less equals to 3 m³/s. Okay, now, so the discharge that can pass through a line canal can be calculated using this formula, where this Q is discharge of the line canal, which is equals to A, means the cross sectional area of the channel section, and V mean is the mean velocity of the water flowing through the channel. And this mean velocity can be calculated using this particular formula, where this N is the rugosity coefficient, this R is the hydraulic mean depth or the hydraulic mean radius, and this S is the longitudinal slope of the water surface. Okay, now, so the maximum permissible velocity for the stone pitched lining will be 1.5 m/s. But if the type of lining is burnt clay tile or the brick lining, then the maximum permissible velocity will be also 1.5 m/s. And for the cement concrete lining, the maximum permissible velocity of water through the canal is 2.7 m/s. Okay, now embankments of relatively permeable soil do not need drainage measures behind the lining. Means if the embankments are constructed with relatively permeable soil, we do not need any kind of under drainage provisions. However, these are the conditions where suitable under drainage measures should be provided to protect the canal lining in accordance to Indian standard 4558. Okay, so if the line canal passes through an area where seasonal groundwater level is higher, likely to be higher than the water level inside the canal, then we should provide under drainage. Now, where the subgrade is sufficiently impermeable to prevent the free drainage of seepage, or you can say the leakage from the canal, we should provide the under drainage. And if there is, you know, the built up pressure due to the time lag between the drainage of the subgrade, the following drawdown of the canal, we need to provide the under drainage. Okay, now, so these are the typical cross sections of line canals. All the design parameters we have discussed in this particular lecture, such as the freeboard, the dowels, the bank width, the berm, roadway and drainage, the side slopes, etc., are shown in these figures. Apart from that, the typical dimensions of various design parameters are also given. Okay, so this is it for today. In our next lecture, we will discuss about the design steps of the line canals with the help of some numericals. Till then, stay safe and stay happy. Thank you.